I'm Zane Lamprey. In this episode, I go three sheets to Newcastle. I drink Newcastle beer, I drink real ale, and I have some guys spin around me with swords. It's a good show, and I don't know how to get out of it. Ow, ow, ow.
Every night, in every city around the world, it happens. People pour into local watering holes to, well, drink. It's my mission, that's me, to traverse the globe getting to know these different people and their drinking customs. Bellying up to the bar, and with any luck, making some new friends.
Warning, when drinking in Newcastle, be mindful where you sit.
The one, that's the one. Yeah.
What?
You'll see more of that later.
Stop it, Tom. Am I haunted now?
But first. Newcastle, not just a beer, but also a place in northeastern England. Back in the 11th century, the son of William the Conqueror built a new castle as a stronghold. And ever since then, they've called the town Newcastle. Today, the locals, known as Geordies, are notorious pub hounds. And there's a watering hole on every corner with interesting drinks and interesting characters. And that's why the only way to really appreciate this renowned drinking destination is through sheer volume. I'm talking pub crawl. When I go,
Fish Newcastle! Hot sale!
No, this is a family show. Not my family. Newcastle is a football kind of town. That's soccer to you and me. And in honor of that, we kick off this pub crawl across the street from the stadium where Newcastle United plays, at a bar called the Strawberry. I'm here with John Sford. Like, you guys don't know who this is. Daft wankers. Known as the Bez in these parts, John played for Newcastle United from 1992 to 1998. He's a legend.
That's it.
A legend for Newcastle United. As for what he drinks, you're probably thinking a Newcastle ale, right? But think again.
Right, now I'll have a Budweiser.
Who?
When in Rome. Budweiser, is that
right? What the hell is that? What is that? That sounds fun and fancy. Yeah. It's a Budweiser.
Yeah.
He's a king of beers kind of guy. But as an out-of-towner, he thinks I should have the local favorite.
Newcastle Brunel. Oh, yeah. Save it.
Did you expect me that I had never had Newcastle Brown?
I didn't know if you actually tasted
my favorite beers.
Yeah.
Not only do I like Newcastle, I happen to know all about it. Here at the brewery where Newcastle Brown Ale is made, the entire process is automated. So this is like the bridge.
This is our starship control area.
Okay. Graham, the plant manager, is showing me around. You mind if I just start the mash up? Okay. I mean, this is typical. Go to commands and then go to MCV, the mash conversion vessel. What brew number are we on?
623.
And then just start the job from there. Yeah. If you want, you guys can all sort of just take a holiday and I can just run everything. Now, water and malted barley are pumped into the mash conversion vessel. This is my beer.
Ethiopia, you started that off.
How long does it sit?
Oh, 25 minutes.
The mixture, or mash as it's called, will be pumped into giant fermentation tanks where it becomes a fermenting porridge called wort. At what point can I taste it?
After it's been filtered.
Let's go to that room. Steve, the quality control expert here, pours me a sample that's been fermented and filtered. You guys might be onto something. After batches are bottled and pasteurized, they do a final test in the QC department.
What do you guys call this?
Spider diagram.
The spider diagram. Looks like a spider web. And then you can see here, this is what a Newcastle Brown should taste like. And it leans towards fruity, estuary, and everything. Less hoppy than other beers.
So, does it taste like the shape?
Let me tell you. Aces. Thanks, guys. That was awesome. Right. I just have one more thing to do. Just a little thing. Just, could you guys just do, go like this real quick? It's just a tradition. Just kind of cover your eyes. And then just, what you want to do is, just kind of keep your eyes shut for a little bit. And then, whoops. All right. Yeah. 10 minutes, open them up.
I think he's pinching my bottle, Graham.
Don't worry. Security will get him.
Back at the Strawberry.
What? What happened?
Hanging out with the Bez is starting to bring out the competitor in me. Maybe I, too, could have been one of the greats. Of course, the Bez is probably a little better at football than Eric the Sound Guy. So maybe I should stick to what I know best.
Do you want to have a chugging contest?
What's a chugging?
See who can drink the beer the fastest?
I'll have a go.
Yes, he'll have a go, but only on one condition.
I can chug
I'll tell you.
I'll
tell you
what. I'm going to chug, and then we're going to have
and
a...
And then we're running.
Have an action.
Yeah, he's got, we combine a bit of athleticism in. Is that good?
That's fine.
Yeah?
On your mark.
Oh,
yeah.
Set.
Go. Hey. You said you picked it up before you said
no,
go.
No. It's a professional.
You can't do that.
It's a professional. Go on.
Go. What do I win?
You win.
Okay, I wasn't expecting this, but apparently I do win something.
This is for you.
Are you serious?
This is for you. Nah, don't even dare touch it.
What?
Right?
You just said I won it.
That is
special. Whoa!
That is special, by the way. Not only that, you have
to- I want to touch it!
You got to kiss the badge.
I'll kiss the badge.
There you go. Right.
Did you know I was going to win?
I'd have took that home if I'd have won.
You so this is your number?
That was my number.
And then instead, you made it the show. You put three sheets on
I said he's shit, but they put sheets.
My very own, customized, Newcastle United three sheets jersey.
Now we have to do our other thing?
Well.
Let's go.
Yeah, we got that.
All right.
Right.
I guess we're all winners here. And now, proudly bearing my Newcastle colors, I must be moving on. Coming up, one of Newcastle's most revered drinking haunts.
And that's when Charlie the Ghost got really annoyed, really angry.
Really?
I'm pub crawling through Newcastle, England. And my second stop is a place called the Old George, which has been here since the 1600s.
Cheers.
Cheers.
The guy I'm drinking with is local historian Tom Keating, which gets me thinking, now might be a good time for you to partake in something I call getting drunk off history. Every time Tom reveals a new historical tidbit, you drink.
One of the historic stories associated with this goes right back to the time of King Charles I in the 1600s.
Okay.
1646, he was actually here. And he used to come in here and enjoy a beer.
In the 1600s?
In the 1646. 1646, he used to come
wow.
here, game of golf. He was looked after in the city. He wasn't a prisoner. But he was held captive in the city, but he was quite free to wander.
That was after he dismissed Parliament.
That's right, that's
and
right.
And then
reinstated Parliament when he
was. Yes, that's right. And eventually he led to civil wars. And he used to come and he used to sit in this pub in one particular chair.
A haunted chair?
Yes. And you're sitting on it, actually.
What?
Yes.
Stop it, Tom! Am I haunted now?
No, no, you're not haunted, don't worry. But the room is called the King Charles Room because of that. So the history of this, the ghost of King Charles is supposed to haunt this place. And this chair you're sitting on is the chair that he used to sit on.
This chair is 400 years old?
Yep, more than 400 years old. In the 1970s, the chair was taken away and repaired because it wasn't in very good condition. And that's when Charlie the ghost got really annoyed, really angry.
Really?
And would often throw things around in this room. So with things like beer mats and...
Notepads, by any chance? Cute.
Okay, in the spirit of preventing you, the viewer, from getting too drunk off history, I think it's time to move on to other things.
I'm gonna mosey on my way.
Cheers.
And try not to get anything thrown at me on the way out.
Good.
And what I'm moving on to is a pub called the Crown Posada. To drink with a couple of real ale hardliners. Bill, the head barman, and Alistair, the ale aficionado.
Your normal keg beer is dead. This has had the life pulled out of it with, by pasteurization. Yeah. This has got natural carbonation. Yeah. There's no artificial carbonation at all.
Which one should we kill first? This guy? This is called Hadrian Brewery. This is, I'm assuming, based on the wall, Hadrian's Wall, which was the northernmost front of the Roman Empire. Does that impress the out of you or what?
Roman Emperor Hadrian had a wall built around 122 AD. It stretches from the west coast of England, just below modern-day Scotland, to the town of Wallsend, a few miles northeast of Newcastle.
All right, cheers.
Cheers.
It's noticeably less carbonated.
Yeah.
Here's the problem that I see with this. No bubbles. It's much easier to go through them.
Yeah. Well, this is why this level alcohol is 3.8.
3.8.
Usually you just call it a session beer because you can have a session on it.
Well,
and it's not gonna knock your head really, you know, unless you have 25 pints.
Okay, so it's easy to pound. Now, time to sip it for flavor.
What I find with that one is the malt predominates.
Yeah. Historical fact that hops don't grow in a sort of colder region. So to bring them from the south of England, they're a bit more expensive. So typically northern beers are made fewer hops, more malt.
Alistair doesn't think my session will be complete without tasting one of his favorites. The more hoppy Rivet Catcher, named after some tough guys from the old days of the Newcastle shipbuilding industry.
The guy would be up on a scaffold, probably about 200 feet above ground level.
Put the rivets into the ship.
Heat the rivets up to white hot.
Yeah.
Throw them with a sling.
It'll go into the bucket, grab it, throw it in the hole.
Yeah, bang it in, yeah.
Bang it in, and it starts to expand.
Yeah.
That was the Rivet Catcher.
Yeah.
That guy's badass.
Yeah.
Right?
You know.
This better be a badass beer, is all I can say.
There's a grassy aroma to it, and you get that on a first sort of mouthful. Then it develops
it's a bit fruity as well.
Malty, fruity, a lot of fruit in there.
Smell is grassy, sort of vegetable-y, and then fruity, and then the taste is very, very hoppy.
Yeah. And it lingers a long time. You've got a lovely lingering bitterness and.
Yes, the beer does have a lovely lingering bitterness, but the drinking has been oh so sweet.
Thank you. Thank you. Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you, Alistair.
Now I'm off to a part of town called the Diamond Strip to drink at a loggia with a big shot in the local drinking scene.
Steve is a man about town, whatever that means. He's known to be someone not to be trifled with. How's that?
Polite.
That's polite.
Steve Wraith is 100% Geordie. And he's gained a high profile around here after publishing a book about his very low profile associations with the Newcastle organized crime scene.
You're gonna educate me to the life of a Geordie?
We're drinking John Smith's Extra Cold, which is served at 37 degrees Fahrenheit. About 15 degrees colder than most English cask ales.
Mm.
You're gonna find that it's creamy, light, delicious, and leaves no bitter aftertaste.
Okay. Wow. John Smith's.
It's pretty good. Yeah. Maybe better than me?
A little bit.
Okay, he's good. I'll give him that. Now, would I make a good Geordie? Time to whip out the Three Sheets book of local slang. First off, how a Geordie agrees with someone.
Why I man.
Man?
Yeah.
Why?
Nice pint of John Smith, son.
Why man?
Now, how to get a Geordie to follow you somewhere.
And how here means come on.
So it means like, come on, man.
Yeah. How here?
How here, man? Mm-hmm. How here?
Finally, how to tell a Geordie you're about to go bar hopping.
If you're going out on a night out.
Yeah.
I'm gunning to the tune.
Oh, that's, I'm going out on the town.
Yeah, I'm gunning to the tune. I'm gunning to the tune.
All of this Geordie talk probably has you wondering where the word Geordie came from. Professor, help us out with this.
Why, yes, Dave. The etymology, that means origin of the word for you uneducated masses, is unclear. However, one theory holds that during the Jacobite Rebellion of 1745, many Jap began calling the people of Newcastle Geordies because of their loyalty to King George II. Another popular belief is that the term came about when local miners used so-called Geordie lamps named for their maker, George Stevenson, rather than the more common Davy lamps named for their maker, Humphrey Davy. Interesting.
Nice pint of John Smith's, that, isn't it?
Why, Eamon. Gonna do. How, Eamon?
Coming up, cocktails with this guy. Right now, I'm on a pub crawl through Newcastle, England, Eve the Geordie. He's taking me to my fifth bar of the day called Popolo to drink with a buddy of his.
This is your buddy here?
Yes, uh-huh.
This is Mickey. He's a chef at a local restaurant, and he's not on his first or his last drink of the night. The reason we're here is because up until now, I've only been in pubs drinker. But these guys think it's important to point out that there's another side to Newcastle's drinking scene.
This is the new kind of culture in Newcastle.
Okay.
They have several specialty cocktails here, which we're gonna check out, starting with something called the Basil Grand, which is made with fresh strawberries and muddled basil, Stoli vodka, Grand Marnier, raspberry liqueur, lemon juice, and cranberry juice. For ice, poured into a martini glass and topped off with more basil and black pepper.
Down in one, down in one, come on. Down in one, come on.
Sure. That's actually all right.
Yeah, it's not so bad.
You look surprised.
I'm surprised, man.
I must admit, I disagree with putting anything like that in. I know it's arty farty for me, that. I would object to that.
Yeah, it's arty, me too, I object to it. Wow, it worked. Cheers.
Cheers, down the hatch.
Bye-bye.
I like basil, mate. I don't care what they say, I like basil.
Nice drink, shame about the greenery.
It's a shame about the greenery.
Next up, a so-called amber.
So we have freshly pounded ginger. Are you paying attention?
And the next is familiar. Remember when I was in Poland? How about something that's illegal back in the States?
This is the bison grass vodka.
Yeah.
Obviously it has the grass in it.
It's vodka infused with bison grass. You can get a modified version of it in the States where the blood-thinning compound in the bison grass is not present due to FDA regulations.
Okay. What's next?
This is 40-proof apple schnapps, then apple juice, and some ginger syrup, shaken with ice, and poured over ice.
Let's have some of that.
He always comes prepared.
No, I think I'll just take mine if that's all right.
Okay, not bad, but definitely on the sweet side.
This is a pinky up drink, because quite frankly, it's too much sugar, and I'm sweet enough.
Sensing we want something a little bit tougher, the bartender serves us brandy on the rocks. As we sip on our gentleman drinks, it dawns on me. I've been to 5 bars over the course of about 10 hours. Tomorrow could be painful, but probably not as painful as for Mickey.
You know what? Get it out of your system. Get it out.
I wonder what kind of shape he'll be in.
Here, chef, will you chef me up some, like a hangover breakfast? And that'll be our hangover cure?
Definitely.
Awesome. All right, I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, Mickey. Cheers.
Just when I think the night is over, Steve realizes that no drinking excursion to Newcastle is complete without at least one drink at a bar called the Carnes. Why come here?
It's because the entertainment is a cut above the rest.
A cut above the rest?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Have a look for yourself.
These guys are called rappers. No, not as in hip hop, as in the ancient form of dance involving stomping and swords that has its roots right here in Newcastle. Well, not only do they put on a good show, they're happy to accept a round of liquid thanks.
Greasy's Newcastle, haven't pub crawled until you've pub crawled in Newcastle. Why, I'm a.
It's the next morning. After hopping 6 bars in one day, I'm hoping that the breakfast Chef Mickey promised me last night might do some good. The restaurant he works at is called Bacchus. They specialize in traditional local foods.
Well, you've got a really bad hangover. It's got to be black pudding.
Which apparently involves a lot of protein. Along with the black pudding is Cumberland sausage, smoked herring, what they call kip, and a pork sausage sandwich.
Well, a bit of food down your neck.
Yeah.
And a double vodka Bloody Mary. Cheers, me dears.
And cheers be to Newcastle, where you might start off running, but you'll probably end up crawling.
Ring ding 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 ding.
Take a frog, better give it some frog.
Kick it. Boom 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 boom. No, I'm the background. You take the lead. You sing.
Who won that?
You had a head start.
See.
He even knows your name, you know why? Not because you played football, because he arrested you. Get out of here.